forgotten sun.
Only forgotten sun.
For when the world around was bound for hell.
For every hope was gone. What we needed was the grace and mercy God provided on a rugged cross.
Many men have tried to be sad.
That's all you need. The grace and mercy God provided on a rugged cross. Now I got to get my oxygen back. Well, good evening, everybody, officially. It's good to see each one out to the service tonight. And if you haven't been blessed already, there's still a good chance you will. I'm sure as we sing the word of the songs and listen to the spoken word tonight by our brother, you're going to be blessed. So now I'm going to ask you to turn to number 25 in the chorus book. Stand, and then we're going to have the opening hymn number 35. But if you're a Christian here tonight, this should be your goal. Save to tell others of the man or the Christ of Calvary. Number 25, and remain standing for the opening hymn. We are never, never weary. Children of the Lord have a right to shout and sing.
Amen.
Amen. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we truly thank you tonight for the Lord Jesus Christ, for the one who came and made it possible for those of us that have placed our faith and trust in thee, that we are assured of the place in heaven. We're going by and by to the palace of a king. Glory to God. Hallelujah. What a day that will be when we look upon the face of the one who loved us and redeemed us with his own precious blood. But Father, tonight we're concerned for those that may be here in the service tonight that still yet have never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And we pray that tonight will be their night. It'll be the time when they will realize that to die without Christ is to go to a lost eternity. And so it is our prayer tonight, Lord, that before they leave these walls, that they may come to know him, whom to know is life eternal. So we just commit now this service into your hands and keeping, Lord, asking your blessing to be upon it, as we pray in the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, we're going to be favored with two selections at this time. The first one is a duet, Unfailing Love, and then a solo, Without Him, followed by the choir, Christ Arose.
Thank you. they could do nothing without him. I'd surely fail. Without him, I would be drifting like a ship without a sail.
Thank you.
given. Heaven's gates are open wide. Peace abound. Peace abound. Peace abound. Peace abound.
Thank you, duet and solo and choir, for those beautiful pieces.
Tonight I want to talk to you about special things that God has in store for His children. In fact, things that God already does. I'm going to just give you one verse at this time in Psalm 119 and verse 65. It says, Thou hast dealt well, underline the word well, all right? Thou hast dealt well with thy servant, thy children, according to thy word. Now there are many others, of course, many other scriptures I could quote you. And I will be referring to a couple of them. And like in Isaiah, chapter 54, and we have God's special interest in his children. He said, though the mountains be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee, neither shall my peace be removed. And John chapter 10 and verse 14, the Lord says, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I'm known by my own. There are some wonderful nuggets of truth there. The Lord is saying, I'm going to be with you. I'll never depart from you. We have someone to pray to. You talk about the benefits of being a child of God now. You first of all, you have his salvation. When you come to him, you believe. And the wonderful thing about the belief in the Lord Jesus is that you receive him as your personal Savior. You accept him, and you realize that he died for you on the cross. You can't merit it. You can't buy it. You certainly can't work for it. We'd have people bragging in heaven all through eternity if they got there on their own works, or if they bought it because they're rich. And you and I won't have much. We just get there by the skin of our teeth, and we won't have much to boast about, you see. But no, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. Hallelujah. And we give him all the credit. We give him all the praise. And we give him all the worship. And we give the Godhead the same. My Father, my friends, let me tell you, our Father God planned it all for us. And it didn't catch him by surprise. And he said, but my kindness, even if the mountains disappear, but my kindness will never disappear from you. We have kindness, neither shall my peace. We have peace with God. We have peace with God. And the world is clamoring for peace tonight. Not long ago, I gave a message on peace. And I tell you, it's a wonderful thing when you stop to think of it. And you could have peace, excuse me, in the face of adversity. The Church of Jesus Christ is persecuted out in the East. And we have documented stories and incidents, how they are tragically being treated. But you know something? Many of them that have been persecuted, martyred for the sake of Christ, they die with the peace of God in their heart. When you stop to think of that, it just shows you that God gives grace even in a time of adversity, in a time of persecution, and even in the time of death. He said, the good shepherd knows his sheep, and he's known by us. Isn't that wonderful? There's that close relationship. There's that walk with him. And I think of one of the great missionaries of years gone by, John Patton. He was in an island serving the Lord where cannibalism was practiced. Now that's a scary thing, knowing that it's a possibility that you might be boiled in a cauldron in their pot and become a stew for some of these people who were barbarous cannibals. And but while John Patton was there, a man who had a great love for God, his little child died. And he took him to the grave with his wife, and he sang a song at the grave. And they couldn't understand that. How could a man sing with the loss of his child? But then, to compound his sorrow, his wife died. And John Patton at the graveside sung, does Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth or song? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. And he went on to sing the entire song. It was singing the song in the face of sorrow that the people said, this is not an ordinary man. And it wasn't long until they inquired, and John Patton was able to lead them to Christ in maybe a slow fashion. It took a while until that community were changed from cannibalism. The power of the gospel, wherever it has made inroads in the world, their changes have been phenomenal. It's been supernatural. It's been powerful. And this same change can come to you. What God does for his children, he can do for you as well. And we want you to get on board. We want you to realize Christianity is not boredom. It's not coming and sitting in the pews and just singing hymns. And you look at us sometimes and you wonder, why do they go to church two or three times a week and they're singing? What do they get out of life? That's all they get? Man, why don't they come to the party? Why don't they come down to our drinking bout? Why don't they come and try and experiment some of our marijuana and some of our cocaine? Look at your members in your clubs. Human derelicts, their bodies are wrecked. They look miserable, they're pale, pallid. The whole life, we're sorry for you, by the way. We pray for you all of the time. I'm speaking like this because, by contrast, you look terrible. Because the wages of sin is death. But you don't just die like that. And you will die. You could write it down. But you're dying a slow death because of the lifestyle that you live. That's what the Bible means when it said the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ the Lord. That slow death that you're having or going through, and then one day it culminates when you breathe your last breath and you're gone. But the problem is, where are you when you're gone? Where is your destiny? Where are you going to be? It's only going to be heaven or hell. And I say that with all the compassion of my heart. You've heard me tell before. When I was a young preacher, I loved to dangle sinners over the mouth of hell. Some people said I ought to start doing it again. But I believe that I was not in the right spirit, that had the right attitude. But now I have more compassion, more love. I preach the same message. I tell the same truth, that if you will not repent, you will perish. My friend, it's a solemn thing to die without Christ. Believe me, it is. And so we come to our thought of what, I just want to relate to you some of the benefits of a Christian, of a child of God. And what about the comfort of the child? Not just the care of the child of God, but the comfort. He's there to protect us. He has our angels to take care of our children. And sometimes God wants a little one to go home to be with him. That's his prerogative. He's sovereign. He may do that. He took my little boy home. He was only four. God wanted him home. Sure, I miss him. He would have been 50 years this week old. But let me tell you something. I believe he's going to get a new body. I believe we're going to see him in the coming day. I really do. With all my heart and soul. Oh, my friend, listen. Absent from the body is to be present with the Lord when we die. Can you say that? That's one of the benefits, some of the benefits of the Christian. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Hallelujah. He's always with us. He's always there. He's by our side. He's our guide. We pray to him. He answers our prayer. We're seeing great things happening through prayer. We know he's alive through the answering of our prayers so many times. My friend, listen, Christianity is a real thing. We can trust our God. John 14, it's a favorite of all of the church. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. Let me tell you, we're going to have no broken down cottage over yonder. Our place is going to be beautiful. And the thing is this, we're never going to be tired. And you walk the street of gold in the city, four square. And you all are clamoring for gold now. So much gold, forget it. One man said in advertising gold, you know, gold never goes down. It always goes up. That week it went down $150. I haven't heard him since, by the way, about gold doesn't go down. But the point is this, man, I'm going to be walking on that stuff in the coming day. All the gold, But that's not going to be the charm of heaven or the beauty of it and the city fourth square and everything that God has provided for us in the coming day. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He's going to be with us when trouble comes. And that's why he tells us, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I repeat, if it were not so, I would have told you, but I go to prepare a place for you that where I am, there ye may be also. That's the beauty of it all, to be with Christ. Just like the little black boy, when he said, I long to be with Jesus, because where he is, it's going to be wonderful. I'll go with him everywhere he goes. Well, suppose he goes to the end of the world. He says, I'll go with him too. Ah, he says, but suppose he goes in the far distant planets of heaven. He says, I said, I'm going to go there too. He says, but suppose Jesus goes to hell. And the boy looked up at him and said, sir, don't you know where Jesus is? There is no hell. I tell you, it takes a child sometimes to baffle the so-called genius of the educated. He was right on target. There is no hell where Jesus is. There's the comfort of his presence and the comfort of his place, the comfort of his peace. Psalm 23 is still the best. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The problem in the world today is they're always wanting. But in that day, you learn the wonderful truth. We won't want because we'll have everything. You won't need anything. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. How many people are scared to death to die? Oh, I talked to a friend of mine years ago. He called us along with another brother and myself. We went there and he says, I want to tell you, gentlemen, I am scared to death to die. And you could see he was trembling and shaking. And we talked to him. We told him where death was not an awful thing once you knew the Lord. He said, I know all of that. But he couldn't bring himself to trust Jesus that day. Hallelujah. But he did not long after that. He gave his heart to Christ. He had assurance. He had peace. And so death came to him eventually, but it had no fear, no terror in his life. The sting was taken out of death. It was taken out of the grave. Victory, the grave to him was victory and triumph. And that's the way it is with a believer. As I mentioned in another sermon, when you die, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You know anything better than that? The rich man, it says, when he died, he was buried. And he opened his eyes, being in torment. He saw Lazarus and Abraham afar off. And he said, oh, Abraham, Abraham, let Lazarus dip the tip of his finger and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. And Abraham said, remember, son, and call him son, by the way. Remember, in your lifetime, you had good things. To paraphrase it, your table was laden with steaks. And you ate consumptuously. And you had everything at your disposal. You had servants. And you had no care in this world because you were rich. And you had everything. But Lazarus had nothing. The dogs came and licked his sores, which perhaps were the only comfort poor Lazarus had. And he ate the crumbs from your table. Then one day the Spirit of God was escorted by the angels of God into the courts of glory. And Lazarus went home to heaven, and here he is today. But you were buried, and your soul was escorted to hell. My friend, let me tell you, it's real. Jesus told this incident. You need to pay heed to what Christ says. Yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Let me tell you something. I've got my daddy over there. I've got my mama over there. I've got my mother-in-law over there. I've got my father-in-law over there. I got my brother, my second oldest brother over there who died at 53. And I got a lot to look forward to. I got my little boy over there. I got my wife who left me about 8 years ago. I didn't lose her. He just left me. She'd gone before me, that's all. She's gone to glory. And it's something when you think of it. All of the loved ones that died in Christ, when we get to glory, we're going to see them again. Isn't that wonderful? That's enough to praise God. Like my good friend Hubert Smith used to say, that's stomping ground. I get carried away a little sometimes. Can't help it. You can call me Pentecostal, charismatic, call me what you like. I'm just a happy dude tonight. That's a happy child of God. Got a lot going forth. I don't deserve it. It's all because of the grace of God. Praise be to his name. Yes, my friend. And the third thing is the country of the child of God. The care of the child of God. The comfort of the child of God. And now the country of the child of God. I mentioned it in another sermon. But when you stop to think of the country of the child of God, 1 Thessalonians 4:13, I quote again, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who are fallen asleep, those who have died in Christ, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. He says, for we believe that Jesus died and rose again. Even so, God will bring with him those that sleep in Jesus. We will by no means precede those who have died before us. If the rapture takes place when we're alive, they're going to be raised first, and we're going to meet them in the air. Boy, what a day that's going to be. And that's when the change will come. And for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout. And Lazarus, remember, he shouted at the grave, come forth! Lazarus came forth, bound hand and feet. But Lazarus died again. Oh, but like my good friend said recently, that the Christian only dies once. Did you know that? Oh, when your body dies, you'll go to glory. Absent from the body to be present with the Lord. But when you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, you're going to die twice. You say, how could that be? Physically, you're going to die in the coming day. But then when your soul, when you appear and with a form that God's going to give you, and you're going to stand at the judgment bar of God, and you're going to plead for mercy, the books are going to be open, and he's going to tell you, relate to you, the things that you were shortcoming in, that is, you didn't believe him, you rejected him, you had opportunity to become a child of God, to become a Christian, but you said no, you turned your back on him, and he says, I don't know you. I don't know you. Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting perdition, everlasting fire. And the angels are going to come and going to carry you. Now that's going to be the separation from God. The death, the second death I talked about, is not so much the cessation of life. The second death is separation from God forever and forever and forever and forever. And it's going to be with the torments like the rich man. Oh, my God, may he open your eyes tonight. But the country of the Christian is going to be wonderful. And you're going to have a change. When the trumpet of God shall sound, the dead in Christ will rise first. And we which are alive shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. A meeting in the air, that's what it's going to be. But it's also going to be music in the air. I don't know what kind. All I know that it's going to be precious. I just believe it's going to be wonderful. And there's going to be, and I use a big word here, metamorphoso, which simply means a change. You're going to have a new body. You're going to have a body that will never get sick. There'll be no cancer. My good friend, Brother Ira, I hope he doesn't mind me mentioning this right now. Iris, not a well man, plagued with cancer. His wife, Berlin, is in the hospital with cancer. Her daughter, Gloria, God bless that woman. She'd gone through so much. I don't know how she does it, Only the grace of God has sustained her. Mother and daughter are in the hospital with cancer. And then her son, Johnny, also has cancer. But he's doing a lot better. He's on the right track. And he knows the Lord. All of these know the Lord. I don't understand this. But I want to tell you the day is coming when these bodies will no longer be wrecked with these diseases. There'll be no cancer in glory. There'll be no heart trouble. There'll be no plagues of any other problems. You'll never see a cemetery in glory. You'll never see a prison. You'll never see a rehab mission. My friend, heaven, the negatives that we've talked about, what's not there. I cannot describe the things that are there. All I know is you're going to be with such energy and with such power, and you're going to be able to soar through the heavens. You're going to be able to soar. And my friend, listen, no transportation is needed. There'll be no gasoline and diesel up there. You will not be propelled by nuclear power. You're just going to, Superman? Man, he got nothing on the Church of Jesus Christ. Now, I want to tell you, Muhammad Ali was one of my best boxers. There's nobody ever came to be a boxer who had the style of Muhammad Ali. I thought the world of him. I'm not much up in the boxing career, but him, he was something else. Ali could really do it. But one day, he happened to be flying on a plane, and he didn't have his seat belt on. And the stewardess said, "Sir, fasten your seat belt." And Muhammad, of course, in his style, says, "Superman don't need no seat belt." And the stewardess said, "Superman don't need no airplane either. Put your seat belt on." And so he did. Boy, but in that day, we'll soar through the heavens. We won't need no seat belt. We won't be escorted by or taken by any chariot. And all I know is we're going home. Blessed be the name of the Lord. What a day that's going to be when we see him for the first time. There's going to be a lot of missing things in the air in that day. And this brings a sad note to our message at this moment. There are family members that are not going to be there. This should sober Christians to pray more for their children and for their families. But they're going to be missing in the air. Are you ready? Are you ready, my friend? Your mommy and daddy are going to be gone. Or maybe daddy's going to be left behind. Are you ready, sir? Mama, are you ready? Children, I urge you, I beg you in the name of Jesus Christ. Are you ready? Because you're going to be missing in the air when he comes for his church, if you're not ready. Bow the knee to Christ. For him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you're going to repent of your sin and receive Christ as your Redeemer, as your Savior. Because he died for you on the cross. And there's no other way but the cross work of Jesus Christ. God gave his beloved Son. I never tire of quoting it. For God so loved the world, put your name there, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, put your name in the whosoever, believeth in him, shall not perish. You will not perish, but have everlasting life. Oh, may God give you the wisdom and the desire tonight to really bow the knee to Christ. Own him as your Savior. Trust him as your Redeemer. Don't put him off. You know, it says the cloud carried him away in his ascension when he rose from the dead. It's amazing how many times the cloud is mentioned in the Bible. The cloud burst of the flood, but there it was nothing but judgment. But God promised it with a rainbow that he would never do it worldwide again. But there was a cloud burst in the flood. Cloud covered the Israelites in the wilderness. That was for protection and to give them light in the nighttime for the Israelites. A cloud filled the temple in Solomon's day. That was for worship. God couldn't show himself. because you can't see God and live in this body. Believe me, you die. But oh, the cloud that filled the place. The priest couldn't even function. It must have been a hallelujah time in that temple that day, believe me. And so we had that cloud, which is so, so important. You had the Shekinah glory cloud in Ezekiel 18. Now, this is a sad note. In Ezekiel 8, it said then, and he had a vision, Ezekiel had a vision, and he looked, and listen to me, the hole in the wall, and that's not the hole in the wall in Abaco. And what did he see? He saw that so many filthy things that Israel were performing, were guilty of. And then when he looked, he saw the cloud, the glory cloud, lift from the temple of God, hovered over the courtyard. And this really saddened him. Can it be the Shekinah glory is moving? And then it went over to the wall of the city. And then it disappeared out yonder. And the glory cloud never came back to the temple of God after Ezekiel saw it disappear. Until one day, hallelujah, a baby was born in Bethlehem. And that's when the cloud came back. When the angels announced the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, the entrance of the Son of God, now there was a brightness in the sky. At the cross, there was a cloud. It was a cloud of darkness. Darkness like they've never seen before in Israel. And there was an earthquake. Some professed. Centurion cried, surely this was the Son of God. It was a very unique thing. And the temple was rent from, the veil of the temple was rent from top to bottom. Now man could go in today. You need no temple like this. You could go in boldly unto the throne of grace and pray and intercede. Then there was a cloud in his ascension. And would you believe 1 Thessalonians 4 says he's coming back on a cloud. The clouds have a lot to say. That's a subject in itself. Oh, my friend, listen. A young lady, when she was dying, she was only about 18, and she said, Daddy, yes, my dear. Says, you taught me how to hold my cigarettes. You taught me how to act when we go out partying. You taught me how to conduct myself when we went out eating in these high-class restaurants. Daddy, you taught me how to dance. But Daddy, you never taught me how to die. You can imagine this poor man, how he felt. What he said to her, we're not known, we're not told. But there was another lady similar, a young lady. And she was dying too. And she said, Daddy, you said that there is no God. But mommy, before she died, she said, there is a God. And she wanted me to trust him. But you kept saying, that's not necessary, for there is no God. Daddy, mommy said there was. Whom shall I believe? And that father said, because he was convicted, he said, my dear, believe your mother. When you come to the hour of death, you change your attitude. You're fearful, you're frightened, and you're so insecure, and it's terrible. And the only thing to do is bow the knee to Christ and trust him as your Redeemer. And he will remove all the fears and the terror of death. May God help you to do so. Father, how we thank you for your word. We thank you for the way you take care of your children. And it is our desire that men and women everywhere will see this and that they'll bow the knee to the Christ of God. Some who are shackled by sin, loose them tonight, Lord, liberate them. You came to deliver the captive. And then again, for those of God who think that everything is lost in life and maybe they're on the verge of taking their life, oh God, speak to their heart. Show them that this is not the way out. This is not the answer. Help them to realize that Jesus loves them and you love them. Save them is our prayer. for we ask it in Jesus' precious name. My friends, you could give us a call. Our phone number is up on the screen. We'd be glad to help you in any way we possibly can. May the Lord bless you and give you a good night.